You have tonight lecture the concept of justice, how fundamental is it for ethic and political philosophy, from Christoph Horn. And the respondent, Alessandro Pinzani. Christoph Horn is professor of practical philosophy and ancient philosophy at Rheinische Friedrich Wilhelms University. Doctor at Ludwig Maximilians University, München, habilitation at Eberhard Karls University, Tübingen. And Alessandro Pinzani is professor of ethic and political philosophy at the Federal University of St. Catherine, and doctor in habilitation at Eberhard Karls University, Tübingen. Christoph Horn, you have the word. You can begin. Thank you.
Boa noite a todos e a todas. Em primeiro lugar, eu gostaria de agradecer ao professor Nitamar de Oliveira pelo convite tão gentil. Muito obrigado. Unfortunately, absolutely unable to give a talk in Portuguese, so I will now change over to English. Many contemporary philosophers consider justice to be the crucial normative concept of ethics and political philosophy. The theoretical fundamentals for ascribing such a key function to our idea of justice can be traced back, on the one hand, to John Stuart Mill's little treatise Utilitarianism, published in 1861, chapter 5, and of course, on the other hand, to John Rawls's A Theory of Justice from 1971. In my talk, I wish to challenge both of these views by raising a series of objections against those current ethical and political theories which give justice a dominant role. To my mind, we should neither maintain that justice expresses the core of our normative convictions in ethics as well as in political philosophy, nor defend the claim that whenever our crucial normative convictions are involved, we are faced with questions of justice. As I will try to show, our idea of justice is much more specific, a much more specific one. It will turn out to be an important, but nevertheless a subordinate normative concept. In order to achieve my purpose, I provide a series of semantic considerations about the meaning of justice and injustice. In the vast philosophical literature on justice from the last four decades, I found astonishingly few reflections on these semantic fundamentals. In contrast, numerous philosophers and political theorists simply repeat and the shared conviction, which I would like to label the primacy thesis. Let me start with two preliminary remarks. First remark, as I just said, it is certainly a surprising fact that the concept of justice has rarely been the object of close semantic scrutiny. My basic concern here is that within the philosophical debate on Rawls and his use of the concept of justice, the term has started a career as a somewhat semi-technical concept independent of our ordinary use of it. It is then interpreted in an extremely incorrect way, given that the criterion for a correct use is our common everyday application of this term. And it is strongly overrated by philosophers, by lawyers, and by political theorists. namely compared with what we normally tend to think of the importance of justice. I am well aware of the fact that not everybody using the concept of justice as a basic normative concept in his or her moral philosophy or political philosophy wants to give a semantic reconstruction of what we ordinarily are meaning by this expression. Now, of course, every theorist is free to use justice as a purely technical term. In this sense, justice could simply be defined as that what is normatively central in ethics or political philosophy, whatever this might be. One could simply say, let us label justice that which is normatively crucial in ethics or in political philosophy. But this should then be clearly indicated. Most authors, however, suggest that their philosophical considerations are close to how we ordinarily are thinking about justice. Second remark, by pointing out that the emphatic interpretation of justice in moral philosophy and in political philosophy can be traced back to John Stuart Mill, I don't want to claim that he was the philosopher who brought up this way of employing this concept in general. As a historian of philosophy, I know very well that a similar use of justice can already be found, for instance, in Adam Smith, who, for his part, received it as a coinage from the Protestant line of early modern natural law debates. This usage has roots in the medieval natural law tradition and can ultimately be identified in Cicero's distinction between the justum, the honestum, and the utile in his De Officiis, to then, if you want to look it up. But the decisive impact on modern debates is that of Mill's widespread and very influential little treatise. To make this plausible, let us have a look now at the first quotation, which you can find on your handouts. I hope that everybody got one. I quote John Stuart Mill, "When we think that a person is bound in justice to do a thing, it is an ordinary form of language to say that he ought to be compelled to do it. We should be gratified to see the obligation enforced by anybody who had the power. If we see that its enforcement by law would be inexpedient, we lament the impossibility, we consider the impunity given to injustice as an evil, and strive to make amends for it by bringing a strong expression of our own and the public disapprobation to bear upon the offender. Thus, the idea of legal constraint is still the generating idea of the notion of justice, though undergoing several transformations before that notion, as it exists in an advanced state of society, becomes complete." End of quotation. In the quoted passage, Mill tries to identify the core idea behind our notion of justice. For him, justice is a very specific moral sentiment, namely our desire for revenge or retaliation towards the perpetrator of a moral or juridical law. Mill's intention in chapter 5 is to reconcile our justice-based moral intuitions with utilitarianism. According to him, justice has always to do with the desire for compulsion and enforcement. Obligations of justice are those the compliance of which we want to see enforced. Therefore, he contends, claims of justice constitute a normative class of its own, namely the so-called duties of perfect obligation. Let me quote the second passage on your handouts. "Now it is known that ethical writers divide moral duties into two classes, denoted by the ill-chosen expressions, duties of perfection, of perfect and of imperfect obligation. the later being those in which, though the act is obligatory, the particular occasions of performing it are left to our choice, as in the case of charity or beneficence, which are indeed bound to practice, but not towards any definite person or at any prescribed time. In the more precise language of the philosophic jurists, duties of perfect obligation are those duties in virtue of which a correlative right resides in some person or persons. Duties of imperfect obligation are those moral obligations which do not give birth to any right. I think it will be found that this distinction exactly coincides with that which exists between justice and the other obligations of morality. End of quotation. Following Mill, the distinctive feature of a duty of justice is that it must be strictly fulfilled by the bearer of the obligation. The bearer has to do precisely defined actions towards precisely defined persons, and so on. This implies the existence of a corresponding right on the part of the addressee. Cases of justice are what we would call negative duties, i.e. obligations to omit violations of basic moral or legal rights. Furthermore, while we react on violations of duties of charity and beneficence with disappointment, we are touched by cases of injustice in a much deeper form. He doesn't say that in that quotation, but he says that in chapter 5. So there's a typical sort of moral emotion connected with duties of justice, namely while we react on duties of charity with disappointment or on a violation with disappointment, we are touched by cases of injustice in a much deeper form. We are outraged and feel the desire for revenge, for sanctions and for punishment. As this emotional reaction shows, we regard the unjust person as someone who acts against absolutely crucial moral rules of conduct. I read now the third passage from chapter 5 of Utilitarianism. To recapitulate, the idea of justice supposes two things, a rule of conduct and a sentiment which sanctions the rule. The first must be supposed common to all mankind and intended for their good. The other, the sentiment, is a desire that punishment may be suffered by those who infringe the rule. There is involved, in addition, the conception of some definite person who suffers by the infringement, whose right, to use the expression appropriated to the case, are violated by it. And the sentiment of justice appears to me to be the animal desire to repel or retaliate a hurt or damage to oneself or to those with whom one sympathizes, widened so as to include all persons by the human capacity of enlarged sympathy and the human conception of intelligent self-interest. From the latter elements, the feeling derives its morality, from the former, its peculiar impressiveness and energy of self-assertion. End of quotation. In this third quotation, we get a certain idea of how Mill tries to interconnect justice and utilitarianism, namely by interpreting justice as an expression of a fundamental anthropological capacity, namely that to enlarge our sympathy to all of humankind and to include other people in our well-considered rational interest. Be that as it may, what we found in Mill's text is the idea of a primacy of justice as a moral concept. Questions of justice are identified with the core of what is morally relevant. As is well known, we find quite a different idea of what is constitutive for the primacy of justice thesis in the early monograph of John Rawls. Here, Rawls is not concerned with individual cases of morality, although the later Rawls shows some deeper interest in justice as a personal feature of individuals. But he considers justice as the most fundamental normative concept of a theory of social institutions. Rawls thinks that a society is fully adequately organized if its basic structure is just. In order to be just, it must consist of institutions which establish a lexical priority for rights and liberties. What he has in mind are the rights and liberties of the early modern liberal tradition, and in this respect, Rawls is not that far away from Mill. In a famous passage from the very beginning of A Theory of Justice, Rawls compares justice as the first and decisive virtue of social institution with truth as the crucial virtue of epistemic systems such as theories. He explains what he means by this analogy and what he means by justice. I quote text number 4. Each person possesses an inviolability founded on justice that even the welfare of society as a whole cannot override. For this reason, justice denies that the loss of freedom for some is made right by a greater good shared by others. It does not allow that the sacrifices imposed on a few are outweighed by the larger sum of advantages enjoyed by many. Therefore, in a just society, the liberties of equal citizenship are taken as settled, the rights secured by justice are not subject to political bargaining or to the calculus of social interests. The only thing that permits us to acquiesce in an erroneous theory is the lack of a better one. Analogously, an injustice is tolerable only when it is necessary to avoid an even greater injustice. Being first virtues of human activities, truth and justice are uncompromising. End of quotation. Apparently, both Mill and Rawls are defending what I called some minutes ago the primacy thesis regarding justice, but they hold it in a different way and in different fields of normative philosophy, and so their positions cannot simply be identified or combined. Although I know of some colleagues who have exactly tried to do this. The first point of my critical analysis hence consists in pointing out a certain confusion. Justice cannot be simultaneously, at least not to my mind, the core of our normative intuitions both in ethics and in political philosophy. Think only of the following intuitive difference. In moral philosophy, the cases which we find most provocative or most flagrant are those of murder, of child maltreatment, of mutilation, physical mutilation, of rape, of lying, of fraud, of theft, and so on. Whereas in the political realm, we are discussing rather questions of freedom and liberties, of equality, of socio-economic deprivation, of paternalism, of oppression, and so forth. In political theories of justice, we are discussing one of the following 7 topics, at least I believe we have to do with more or less than these 7 topics. The first is political justice in the sense of the distribution of liberties, of offices, of chances, of charges. The second topic is socio-economic justice, questions of income, of fortune, of wealth, of tax paying, of redistribution, and so on. The third is gender justice, justice between the sexes. The fourth is intergenerational justice, the fifth is international or global justice, the sixth is juridical justice, all those questions of imputation and of justified punishment and so on. And the seventh and last is medical justice, the distribution of scarce resources in the field of medicine. In none of these discussions, questions of individual morality, as I just enumerated, that is murder, child maltreatment, physical mutilation, rape, and so on, can be addressed. Of course, I admit that one might try to give a comprehensive normative theory, and I myself tried it in several papers, and I will give you at the end of my presentation a short idea of what I think one should do in this field of so-called moral goods, which are relevant both for ethics and for political philosophy. But prima facie, the two uses of justice are far away from each other and cannot simply be combined. Let me now point out the four semantic convictions, the four theses, which I want to defend in my talk. The first thesis is this. The most important or the most provocative or the most flagrant problems of morality are not, as John Stuart Mill claims, simultaneously questions of justice. In contrast, there exist only very few cases in which these core problems of morality, of morals, are at the same time questions of justice. That's my first point. My second thesis, vice versa, questions of justice are not always at the same time essential cases of morality. In contrast, there are very few cases in which instantiations of justice are at the same time core problems of morality. Sometimes we are even faced with cases of justice or injustice which are morally neutral or depend on deeply immoral presuppositions. Third thesis, not all of the core problems of political normativity can meaningfully be subsumed under the heading of justice. There are challenges in political reality which should not be regarded as questions of justice at all, or which are normally not regarded as questions of justice at all. And fourth thesis, vice versa, questions of justice in political philosophy do not cover all what we wish to see realized in our social reality. So let me start with my first point. I would like to reject the idea that the most relevant questions of morality are, as Mill claims, simultaneously such of justice. One of the few quotations which I found in this vast literature which I mentioned, but it is a classic, it's not one of the contributions discussing Rawls, it is a real classic of the philosophy of law and of right, which I found to corroborate my view, is a short remark made by H.L.A. Hart in his Concept of Law from 1961. I quote text number 5 on your handouts. There are indeed very good reasons why justice should have a most prominent place in the criticism of law arrangements. Yet it is important to see that it is a distinct segment of morality and that laws and the administration of laws may have lack excellences of different kinds. A man guilty of gross cruelty to his child would often be judged to have done something morally wrong, bad, or even wicked, or to have disregarded his moral obligation or duty to his child. But it would be strange to criticize his conduct as unjust. Unjust would become appropriate if the man had arbitrarily selected one of his children for severer punishment than those given to others guilty of the same fault, or if he had punished the child for some offense without taking to see that he really was the wrongdoer. What HRA Hart expresses here is in fact the core of my first criticism, of my first thesis. The primacy thesis in law philosophy neglects or ignores that we can call nearly none of the core examples cases of justice. Take for instance murder. We clearly consider cases of murder to be instantiations of what Mill calls violations of perfect duties. Of course, we have strong negative moral emotions against a murderer, and of course, we wish to see him arrested and punished by the legal system. Yet, we would not call it a case of injustice, is in none of the modern languages which I know, or at least believe to know. The same holds true for all other paradigmatic cases that I listed before, i.e. child maltreatment, physical mutilation, rape, lying, fraud, theft, and so on. None of them has anything to do with justice. A very telling observation which unmasks the confusion that is at stake here, at play here, is that many defenders of the primacy thesis use the example of a children's birthday party. The injustice committed at such a birthday party is typically that of a child which receives a smaller piece of cake than the others, i.e. we are faced with a violation of the principle of equality, or the case in which the child receives a smaller piece than it merits or deserves, that is a violation of the principle of meritoriousness. This shows, and I will come to this back in a moment, that justice is a highly specific normative idea. Let me add two observations to the case of a children's birthday party. The first observation is this. Mill is completely right in claiming that cases of injustice are connected with deep feelings of outrage and of moral frustration. The child who is disadvantaged will certainly feel strong emotions and will cry and weep. But this doesn't prove that there has occurred a hard case of immorality, a violation of a perfect duty. Even the opposite holds true. If the father or the mother preparing the cake for the children's birthday party had to do so, preparing the cake, if the, they if they had failed to do so, excuse me, if they had failed to do so, and if the rest of his or her helpless attempts to prepare a cake had ended up in a rubbish bin, no child would have been mistreated at all. Here comes my second observation. The underprivileged child who receives a minor piece of cake is in fact damaged, if we want to use the term damage at all, only in the surplus zone of his or her possession of goods. Even if it feels strongly discriminated or disrespected, and here Mill is clearly correct, he is right in claiming that, the child is not mistreated in a moral sense, it is damaged only in the surplus zone of its infrastructure of goods, if you want. But don't there exist examples of moral cases which are at the same time violations of perfect duties and cases of injustice? Well, let me try to give some examples. Suppose that in the army of your country, a military instructor privileges recruits of his own ethnic origin while seriously distressing and afflicting young soldiers of a ethnic minority. Or suppose a similar case in which a military instructor finds out that one of his recruits is gay, is homosexual, and then starts to humiliate him. In these cases, we are confronted both with essential moral problems and with that what one calls an injustice which cries out to heaven. In which cases now do we face problems of essential morality, and in which cases do we face instantiations of justice, and when do they overlap, if they do in any cases? Let me give you an idea of the difference which is at stake here between the two concepts, two basic concepts, and I have a number of examples. I have a larger version of that in a German essay, and that's what Alessandro read for preparation, the preparation of this of his response. So I have to come back to these examples, but you find four of them on the backside of your handout. I start with my first five examples from the German version. The first example is this. Suppose, imagine a situation in a bakery shop, and the salesperson, the shop girl, so to speak, the salesperson privileges one customer and disadvantages another customer. And she does that for two distinct reasons in two distinct cases. Namely, the first case would be that she has racist motives. She underprivileges a person coming from abroad, I don't know, and privileges a person coming from her own country. Yeah? That's a case of injustice to my mind, which is simultaneously a case of essential moral concern. Whereas, if the shop girl privileges a close friend of her, it's not acceptable at all, of course, but it is not a case of core morality. My second example is that of a tax refugee, and you find many of these guys, of these people, at least in Europe, also in your country, I suppose. This guy, you meet this guy with a suitcase full of euros or dollars or reais, and you are asking him, oh, what are you doing? What are you doing with a suitcase full of money? And he says, I bring it to a tax paradise. I bring it to a tax haven. Since I'm working that hard that I cannot understand why I should pay 50% of taxes, or in France even 60% or more of taxes, it's not acceptable. It's a case of injustice. Now, it is hard to define cases of justice and injustice concerning the payment of taxes, but take it for granted, at least for the sake of argument, that he is right in accusing the tax system of injustice. Take it for granted. And even in this case, we would not facing here a case of core morality. My third example is a futsal example, a football match. And take a friendly game, a so-called friendly game, and in this game the referee decides, meets several decisions which are disadvantages for the external team, for the team which comes from the next village. So it is a very simple game between two neighbor villages, and the referee does not want to be beaten up after the game, and so he privileges the home team and underprivileges the guest team, and so on. And in this case, clearly he commits an injustice, and everybody is outraged from the supporters of the external team. Everybody says, "Oh, it's a tough case of injustice." But even if that might be the case, it's not a case of poor morality. Take a very curious example, my fourth example, that of athletic sports. Suppose a 100 meters hurdles race, and you have six runners who are involved in that foot race, and you offer them, all of them, optimal training conditions for preparation of the hurdle race, and you are promising the first three of the runners a vast amount of money, whereas the last three of the runners must be serving as galley slaves for the next 5 years. And then you say in the end, the first three had the same optimal training conditions and the same equal conditions as the last one. So it is absolutely just and justified that the last one have to work as galley slaves, whereas the first one received millions of reais, and so on. And given that there have been fair conditions, it's clear it's a situation of justice, but it's clearly a case of which offends our intuition of morality. My fifth example is a very classical one. In the Homeric Iliad, Achilles, the hero, is angry and he is outraged since he has been deprived of his young concubine named Briseis. This young woman has been handed over as a honorary present or a gift to King Agamemnon because of his higher rank among the Greek army, in the Greek army, although it was Achilles who has been the most courageous and the most efficient warrior so far. So we clearly have to do with a case of injustice, but in this case we are not only confronted with a situation of moral neutrality, it is even a case of deep immoral slavery. So it was a practice, a common practice in ancient armies to distribute persons as slaves among the soldiers who have gained the victory. So it was quite normal that a hero received a young female captive and used her as a slave. And in this case, Achilles is treated unjustly. It is a case of injustice, but at the same time, we are faced with a problem of deep immorality. And now let us read the four examples of the handout, the examples 6 to 9. The first point is this 1a, just and unjust distribution. A band of robbers is discussing how to distribute the all, according to the rank of a robber, or according to his achievement, or according to his neediness, or according to his health or age, etc. Depending on how they decide, ultimately, we might be willing to concede that their distribution is just. But this just distribution does not legitimize the entire situation in a moral sense. On the contrary, we would say that there is an overriding aspect that determines our moral judgment, namely that the goods to be distributed have been gained before in an immoral way by robbery. note the remarkable fact that a just distribution does not outweigh this immorality. It goes from the moral point of view, it does from the moral point of view not even count here to the slightest extent. B, or case number 7. A group of nuns living in a monastery prepares lunch for homeless people. They do it every day, some days a week, and it is quite a demanding and expensive element in the life of the monastery. Among the homeless coming to the meals is Carl, a funny and good-humored guy who is the favorite guest of the nuns. They always prefer him and give him a better share of the lunch without giving less than a normal share to all other homeless guys. Carl is privileged, but all other homeless are not in danger of malnutrition or starvation. In this case, again, the injustice committed by the nuns does not modify the fact that they are doing a morally admirable job. Again, the aspect of justice does not morally count at all. Eighth case, murder, 2A. There's again a gang of robbers. After having distributed the all, one robber, Jim, brutally kills one other, Tom, from avarice. Suppose that it is a clear case of murder. Assume additionally that the distribution which preceded the murder was unjust, and this injustice was part of the motivation, or was the core of the motivation of Jim to kill Tom. Even then, the only thing that counts for our moral judgment is the murder. Note the fact of an unjust distribution, that the fact of unjust distribution which immediately preceded the murder may explain but not justify the conduct of Jim. In our moral judgment, Jim is guilty of having participated in a robbery and of having committed a murder. The additional aspect of injustice is without any relevance. And my final ninth case, 2B, a group of nuns again on a regular basis serves lunch for homeless people. They are distributing the meals in exactly equal portions. But one day Herbert, one of the homeless, wants to have a double portion. He accuses the nuns of committing cruel injustices, which is a completely unjustified allegation. Bernadette, one of the nuns, a typical nun's name, Bernadette, she becomes so angry that finally she murders. It's not so credible, but she murders Herbert by beating him with a fry pan on his head. In this case, again, the unjust allegation might explain the murder, but not justify it. And the fact that Bernadette is usually doing a morally admirable job does not justify her conduct. Nevertheless, we have to take it into account when we try to give a moral judgment on her. But note that the fact that Bernadette always distributed the meals equally does not count at all for our moral judgment on this situation. Even if she might have been unfair, this would have been an irrelevant part of the entire story. What is justice now? I can come now to an own attempt to give a theory of justice, which is not a Millian and not a Rawlsian theory, but my theory of justice. And I would like to point out that justice is always about the distribution of goods and evils, of merits and goods and evils, of benefits and of disadvantages, of burdens, benefits and burdens, of advantages and disadvantages. Goods and evils cannot be allocated. Moment. I have to go back. Excuse me, I've the wrong paper here. So far my 9 examples which serve to challenge the Millian view, and now I come to my own conclusion. Justice is always about the distribution of goods and evils, of benefits and burdens, of advantages and disadvantages. I hope to have made abundantly clear why I believe that justice is a very specific normative intuition. I think that the Rawlsian position is now much easier to criticize. My first objection is that not everything what can be described in terms of justice belongs to the sort of problem that essential normative questions of the political spheres are. Clearly, many examples of the private, of the personal sphere of agency, which I discussed during the last 15 minutes, also are beyond the interest of political theory, although they are clearly cases of justice. The two oldest paradigms of our Western conceptual history of justice, namely the so-called cosmic justice and justice as a personal virtue, have, for example, a very precarious status in political theory. They are not completely absent in political theory. Both of them are present. I can discuss that during the final discussion, but they are not clearly present to political theory, cosmic justice and justice as a personal virtue. My second objection against Rawls is this: not everything which we want to see essentially realized and which can clearly belongs to our essential normative intuitions can be described in terms of justice. I have serious doubts that even the liberal topic of rights and liberties can be subsumed in a semantically correct way under the heading of justice. That this is impossible is even clearer for normative concepts such as citizenship, participation, sovereignty, common will, and so on, which belong to a Rousseauian republicanism or a Hannah Arendt republicanism, or for Hegelian terms such as Sittlichkeit, recognition, self-respect, or civil society. All of these core normative concepts cannot be subsumed under the heading of justice. A possible third objection against Rawls might be this: it seems to me somewhat artificial to say, as Rawls does, that institutions are normatively perfect, virtuous, desirable, or choice-worthy as soon as they are just, in the same sense in which one might say that normatively ideal scientific theories are simply those which are true or have the best chance to be true. In my view, we additionally wish that institutions should be efficient, non-bureaucratic, inexpensive, flexible, open-minded, slim or lean or whatever, which are features that are not identical with justice, and for which I cannot see a precise equivalent in a scientific theory. As far as I can see, our common idea of justice is now ambiguous and can be basically reconstructed either in an Aristotelian or in a Platonic way. The Aristotelian reconstruction, as developed in the third book of Aristotle's Politics, is the even more current one. We are more familiar with that way of thinking on justice, as Aristotle puts it in the third book of the Politics. Justice is seen in this context as a proportional interpersonal relation with regard to the distribution of goods or evils. According to this Aristotelian idea, a person A merits the good or the evil X, since at the same time a person B deserves the good or evil Y. X is accorded to A because Y is accorded to B and vice versa. So justice here consists in a principle or rule or law of distribution, of a distribution of goods or evils, benefits or burdens on the basis of interpersonal comparisons. Let me try to find that. Just a second. Excuse me. Just a second. But goods or evils cannot only be allocated on the basis of interpersonal comparisons. They can also be assigned simply on the basis of someone's personal claim rights. This is what Plato has in mind when he, in the first and the fourth book of the Republic, accepts the Simonidean formula to give everyone what is owed by him, ta ophelomena hekasto apodidonai. The relevant difference between the Aristotelian interpersonal concept of justice and the Platonic is that the latter is not based on proportionality, on interpersonal relations. What the individuals A, B, and C deserve is simply due to aspects inherent in these persons or dependent on them. The goods or evils X, Y, and Z are not proportional to the relative merits or achievements or faculties and so on of A, B, and C. The Platonic idea of justice can hence rightly be called the absolute concept of justice. So let me come now to my final conclusion. What I would like to say at the end is now, I should come to the end, is now this. I think that the fact that one can reconstruct justice in a Platonic way has misled some of the colleagues, some of the authors. I'm especially thinking of Angelika Krebs in her defense of a so-called absolute concept of justice, to think that the Millian claim that justice is what is crucial to morality can be reconstructed on a Platonic basis. And this is mistaken, to my mind, since we can develop the concept of justice as a dependent justice on a immoral situation. So it's not our basic moral intuition. So that's my conclusion. I have many things to add, but I know I should stop here in order not to be too boring. Mucho obrigado.
I would like first of all to thank Mitamar for the wonderful organization of this Congress. It is very difficult to to put together all the things that have to be put together for this kind of things, and I would really like to thank you very much for the organization. I would like to thank Christoph for this paper, which is, I think, very thought-provoking and extremely dense, and I'm trying now to comment, to make some comments on it. The paper contains many remarks I agree almost completely with, such as the distinction among the different kinds of justice, or his criticism of Mill's confusion of justice as justitia and justice as the instance that implements federal civil law. Well, this is actually in the German version of the paper, but I got the German version, so some of my commentary may looks a little bit Freilandplatz, as out of place, but has to do, of course, with the main topics. However, for the debate's sake, I shall focus on the points that I consider more controversial. Therefore, I shall not resume the paper in its integrity, but only the parts I would like to discuss with Christoph and with the public. In other words, I shall present here a subjective choice of topics among the many ones touched by him in his paper. So I won't go into different kind of justice and so on. The main criticism advanced by Hornig is that justice is an overrated concept in the contemporary political philosophical debate. One could of course reply that this depends on how you define it. It is therefore not by chance that Horn dedicates, well, in the German version of the first part here, almost all of his paper to the definition of justice, more precisely to the discussion of several definitions. An important distinction on which Horn insists is the one between personal and institutional justice, but it were wrong to identify the first one with the field of morality and the second one with the field of politics. Furthermore, it is possible to identify at least 10 classes of possible objects of justice and 8 different meanings of justice, as Horn points out. Well, he was speaking, I was 7 in the, but this is a matter of list. But from the point of view of a semantic definition of justice, it is particularly relevant to distinguish between absolute or relational or interpersonal concepts of justice, which is the last distinction that he made in his speech. The first concept can be reduced to the Ciceronian and Ulpianian formula suum cui quetribuere. Justice has to do with the fact that a person gets what she or he deserves or what is due to her or him. Second concept implies the existence of interpersonal comparisons. Does person A get the same as B or more than B? And what and was this equality or difference justified? I shall come back to this distinction. As I said, Horn's main criticism has to do with the relevance of justice in contemporary philosophical debates. He tries to justify this critique by criticizing the idea that justice stays at the core of morality. He distinguished between morally central and morally peripheral questions of justice. It is not completely clear to me how Horn makes this distinction, and this is missing. In his example of people staying in a queue within a shop, in a bakery, person A is not served because of a race, while person B is not served because the seller gives preference to a friend. In the first case, we have to do with a case of racial discrimination, which represents a form of belittlement of the person and of misrecognition, as Honneth would say. While in the second case, we are faced with a maybe unfair, but not so severe case of partiality, namely of privileging friendship over correctness. But what makes the two cases normatively different? The object of injustice, race there, my right as next in the line here, the attitude of the seller, race is there, partial to friends here, the grade of indignation provoked by this attitude, high there, low here. Let us start with this last aspect. Whose indignation is relevant here? It could be that person A is so used to be racially discriminated that she does not even react with indignation, but with sadness or even with shame, if she has interiorized the racial prejudice. Conversely, person B could feel so outraged by the unfair preference given to the seller's friend that she would fall in a fit of rage that many people will judge as completely disproportionate. So, should we consider only the reaction of an impartial observer C? What if C is a convinced racist, but puts impartiality and fairness over every other value? He would feel more outraged by the injustice experienced by B than by the one experienced by A. In other words, in a racist context, not serving someone because of a race could be an acceptable attitude or represent just a morally peripheral matter. And in a society in which impartiality and fairness are the top values, unduly preference given to a friend could represent a capital violation of the moral code. Of course, this is not tantamount to negating the existence of morally central and peripheral questions. What I would like to do is rather first to question the idea that we can easily distinguish between them. Second, to point out that this distinction is based on the values held by those who was making it. And finally, third, to stress the centrality of the feeling of outrage provoked by the action whose acceptability is being questioned. In the following, I shall deepen these 3 points. I shall discuss point one and point two together. Horn introduced another comparison which should make his position clearer. We cannot put on the same level the kinds of social injustice suffered by the global poor, that was not in the English version, but okay, it's okay, or by the weakest members of society on the one side, and the sufferings experienced by the supporters of a football team, that was in the example, which was damaged through an unjust decision by the referee. This is something that all of us have already experienced. I agree with this, and I think most people would do the same, but there might be some particularly fanatic supporters who put the results of their team higher than everything in the world. We might consider this silly or even outrageous, outrage again, but we need to justify this. Why it is morally unacceptable that a football fan considers it more important that justice be done to his team than to the global poor? Our judgment on his behavior relies evidently on a hierarchy of moral values that we consider objectively valid. It is not just our subjective preference for the poor against his subjective preference for his team. We think that certain issues have objectively a greater moral relevance than others. And we think this because we have, or we think that we have, good reasons for it. We can offer arguments to sustain the claim that the suffering of the poor is morally more relevant than the suffering of football fans. And the main argument has to do with the object of the injustice suffered by both groups. While the poor is threatened in their very physical survival, the fans experience frustration over the score of a football game. Horn does agree with this, and lists a number of goods which he calls morally central, and among which he mentions survival, physical health, bodily integrity, social and political autonomy, etc. Goods such as spare time interests, travel habits, musical or artistic taste, or football faith, and so on the contrary, stay not in the center of our moral concerns, and can be deemed as peripheral. Once again, I agree with him, but I ask myself, and to him, how do we come to this list of central goods? Through empirical studies, as some anthropologists suggest? Do we rely on the idea of a human nature common to every person, like in the tradition, and at least partially in certain essentialist positions nowadays? Or do we try to define the material conditions that everyone needs to satisfy in order to be a moral agent, or more basically, to be a person, to survive and to act more or less autonomously? Or do we appeal to some moral intuition? All these 4 possible strategies to list these morally central goods seem to me to share a premise. They all start from the presupposition that it is possible to identify some common core from which morality can be built or can arise, depending on your believing in moral constructivism, moral realism, moral naturalism, and so on. And I think that Horn does also share this premise. So, let us examine it. This will lead us to discuss the third dimension above, that concerning our feeling of outrage when faced with injustice. Let me first outline my argument. Independently of how you define morality, as a system of principles and norms that aims at regulating human behavior, or as a philosophical debate on these principles and norms, or as an anthropological phenomenon that apparently is present in every human culture and whose roots might lie in our brain, that is, in our neurological structure, as claimed by many authors nowadays. Well, independently of how you define morality, you have to refer to some basic phenomenon that give rise to it. I claim that this phenomenon is precisely the experience of injustice, and that therefore questions of justice are not only morally central, they are rather essential to morality. Most contemporary authors studying the evolutionary basis of morality come to the conclusion that we developed our most basic and most general moral values and principles, that is, those values and principles that are not culture-specific, as a reaction to experiences of injustice, particularly or unfairness and ingratitude, which in every human culture are condemned without exception, while in almost every culture, exceptions are made with regard to acts like killing or even incest, which might be permitted under certain circumstances and under certain conditions. And the same is valid even for pedophilia. There are cultures in which sexual relationship between adults and children are morally permitted. And what is perceived as morally wrong is not the relation in itself, but the fact that, for instance, you have rape. And why? Because you are trespassing some other rights, sometimes the parents' right on the bodily integrity of their children. So not necessarily, it doesn't have to do with a certain value of the person in itself. So I shall not consider here the explanation of this preference for a matter of unfairness and ingratitude given by these authors. Some claim, for example, that unfairness and ingratitude are deleterious from an evolutionary point. They would either make cooperation in a group impossible, or isolate an individual in the group to the point of compromising her or his chances of survival. What I would claim here is rather that experiences of injustice, particularly of unfairness and ingratitude, do not only play an important role within morality, but are at the core of morality itself. It is in the first place a relational kind of justice, particularly when gratitude is involved. But it can also be an absolute one. One could even go as far as to claim that even religion, or at least religious ethics, arises from the experience of what we could call, following Horn's classification, cosmic injustice. Why is this happening to me? What did I do to deserve it? Maybe I did something wrong, even if I did not harm anyone. Maybe I did offend some invisible person or did violate some unwritten order. There must be a reason that justifies my situation, because on the contrary, it would be utterly unjust. The idea that evils inflict upon us for no apparent reason might be cancer or, you know, some accident, might be the punishment for violating some divine moral code, is a good argument for not seeing those evils as unjust, but I shall not follow further this idea in this context. Does this all mean that every moral question can be reduced to a matter of justice? In a sense, it does. Every time you violate what we consider to be our moral duty, we are being unjust towards someone, sometimes even towards ourselves. Morally inappropriate behavior elicits a feeling of outrage among observers that can be assimilated to the original feeling of injustice. When someone is killed in a robbery, We are outraged because it is an undeserved, therefore unjust death, not simply because a life was taken. That a life was taken might cause sadness or despair, even when the death is morally justifiable, in the case of legitimate self-defense, for instance, or of soldiers, or of someone sacrificing oneself in order to save other people's life. But if the robber's life is taken in an act of self-defense, we do not think this is morally wrong, because we do not see this act as being unjust. On the contrary, someone will see it as a form of justice, as we know from the typical discussion that you have in Brazilian public opinion about killing bandits and so on, killing criminals. When someone steals our property, we feel outraged because the act of stealing is unfair, independently from the value of the stolen objects. Then again, if someone stole in order not to starve, we tend to consider this act forgivable because it would be disproportionate, so it's again a matter of proportion and therefore of justice, to put the property right over the right to life. I really cannot see how you can claim that questions of justice are not morally central. Rather, morally relevant questions are always also questions of justice. A last aspect of Horn's paper that I would like to discuss is the following. While discussing the different critics of egalitarianism, Angelika Krebs for instance, Horn shares their basic claim, namely that the relational kind of justice is misleading and leads to neglect the absolute kind. But he goes further and criticizes also the absolute view of justice, or more properly, its centrality for morality. Against this view, he holds once again that morally central questions concern certain fundamental goods, whose value, whose worth, does not depend on their just or unjust distribution. I disagree with this idea. Taking from someone these goods is perceived to be morally wrong, not in itself, but only when it is perceived to be unjust. Let us take again the example of killing. If a soldier kills an enemy who is pointing a weapon against him, we do not consider this to be morally wrong, at least generally. I mean, if you are an absolute pacifist, of course, you would say it's unjust. But if a soldier kills a harmless civilian who does not pose any threat to him, we are outraged and consider this morally wrong. Why? Because this represents an unjust act in an absolute sense. If a shop owner loses his customers to a competitor because the latter is nicer to them or more capable in doing business, we do not consider this morally problematic. They are competing on the same level for the same customers. It is like two children who decide to compete over two slices of a cake, agreeing that the winner would take it all. But if a big retail chain, Walmart, kills all the small enterprises of a town, we are outraged because it would be like an adult taking away the whole cake from a party of children. What is at stake here is not the fact that someone will remain without cake, so without the central goods, but how he is going to lose the cake, or his share to the cake. Even in the case of morally peripheral question, justice is relevant. The moral outrage of the football supporters or of the neglected customer is perfectly legitimate, since the action of the referee and of the seller are contrary to the sense of justice, even if it concerns a small matter. I do not see how you can claim that morally relevant questions concern fundamental goods such as survival, bodily integrity, etc., and claim at the same time that the distribution of these goods is not central to morality. Once you admit that the distribution of this good is central to morality, and it seems to me that Christoph does this, then you are admitting, at least indirectly, that justice is central to morality. So Christoph could reply that my use of the term justice incurs in the same semantic confusion he criticized in Mill and other writers. So just for the sake of polemics, I would like to turn his accusation against him. He seems to offer a characterization of the concept of justice that goes against its meaning both in natural language and in most philosophical discussions, when he disconnects it from the distribution of the fundamental goods that constitute the core object of morality according to his own position. take his example of a band of robbers or of the charitable nuts. What makes the action morally despicable, viz. Admirable, is precisely their being unjust, viz. Just. Robbers act immorally because they steal, that is, because they take away from people their property without having the right or another good reason for doing it. But if the band in question were formed by Robin Hood and his merry fellows, stealing from the vicious and unjust Sheriff of Nottingham in order to help the poor people unjustly exploited by the sheriff, we would not condemn them morally, because they would be just practicing corrective justice. Also, nuns doing charity work are practicing a form of corrective justice, but that gives them no right to privilege Carl the funny guy, and the poor people queuing to get their meals would have every reason to complain, even if they feel grateful to the nuns and consider their work morally admirable. By focusing on questions such as dividing the whole or privileging Carl, Crystal switched our attention from the main question which is on stake. Why do we condemn or admire the actions of robbers or nuns? At the same time, by claiming that the robbers' stealing and the nuns' charity have not to do with justice or injustice, he is offering a, to my view, incomplete and maybe incorrect vision of morality and justice, since he should show us that those actions can be labeled to be morally wrong or right independently from their being connected to their unjust or just character. And it seems impossible, at least to me, to do this without recurring implicitly to the idea of a just distribution of the fundamental goods that are central to morality. So, since he made a very provoking paper, I replied with a very provocative paper commentary, because as I know Christoph, since we are good friends, he will respond in an even more provocative way.
Thank you so much for this extremely accurate and diligent lecture reading of my text, and I'm extremely grateful for several of these points. Basically, I'm very grateful for the fact that you pointed at the core of my paper in the German version, and I wanted to present not too much here. What I developed here first are these semantic considerations which lead me to the following provocative claim. Justice, to reconcile the football fans, so football supporters among you, plays in the second league of our normative convictions. It's not part of the first league of the Serie A, of the football teams, and that is clear from the fact that you have morally absolutely neutral situations in which justice and injustice can be involved, and you have even morally unacceptable situations which can be discussed from a secondary point of view under the description of justice and injustice. So people are enslaving persons and afterwards discussing how should the slaves be distributed among us. And there, of course, there can be a just and an unjust distribution of slaves. You see my point. And that's my reason why I think it is secondary. But Alessandro pointed at the core of my theory, and that is a theory of moral goods. And moral goods, to my mind, he opened up an entire spectrum of different possibilities. To my mind, it can be reconstructed in a broadly Kantian way this theory can be reconstructed as pointing out the transcendental enabling conditions for our capacity to set ends. So it sounds very Kantian. So our capacity to set ends has enabling conditions, to say it a little bit more in the language of contemporary philosophy. So autonomous agency has enabling conditions. And for instance, your bodily integrity and your physical health and your psychophysical well-being counts more for your autonomous agency than your musical preferences and your football interests and so on. So that's what I simply wanted to point out. Of course, we silly persons, more or less silly irrational persons, are in many cases inclined to misinterpret, to morally misinterpret a given situation. For instance, in everyday life, on the streets while driving a car, everybody of us gets very upset and outraged by the slightest violations of our rights and of the rules, which are well-established rules, and so on. Everybody is highly angry about violations of his or her rights, but it is silly. And the same holds true, to my mind, for such a case in a bakery shop. So the queue and the rights and privileges connected with your place in the queue is a quite ridiculous sort of right. If you are underprivileged and you get your bread or your whatever, your cake, 1 minute later, that does not normally damage you at all, or it damages you in your surplus zone of your goods infrastructure, of your axiological infrastructure. Whereas if you are treated inadequately and appropriately, since you are a foreigner, since you have a dark skin or whatever, that makes a considerable difference. That violates you as a person. The considerable difference between a case of the violation of a right in the one case and in the other case can be spelled out in terms of an action theory essentialism. I don't know if you have ever seen these discussions on types of actions. So I believe it is basically an intuition which goes back to Aquinas, to Thomas Aquinas, and the idea is that the essence of an action, so the type to which an action belongs, is constituted by several of its components. And one component, in fact, is the motivation. So, if you have the motivation to hurt someone's feelings, to damage someone from a racist point of view, you want to underprivilege a person since you are full of hatred for this person as being a member of this or that ethnic group, or as being a homosexual, then your motivation is one that gives the entire action a different it makes it belong to a different class. So the change in your motivation
in these two cases, you are the shop seller and you have on the one hand this racist motivation and on the other hand you have this simply friendship based motivation. And the difference between the two cases is a radical one. It's not a superficial one. It makes a radically change in the class of action to which this action belongs. Okay, so of course it can be, as Alessandro pointed out, that the person who is treated in an inappropriate way by a racist does not react feeling outrage and anger, but that's contingent. He or she should feel outrage and anger. Or normally, most of the people who are treated in this way would feel outrage and anger. So that the fact that contingently he does not feel these emotions is not a telling fact. It's not a convincing argument to my mind. At one point of his presentation, Alessandro tended to be a little bit of a cultural relativist in his... I don't believe that racism or that xenophobia or that murder and so on can be seen at any time or at any place as part of the local culture, part of the folkloristic tradition of a culture.
Any time, any place?
So, of course, several times I used the example of Achilles and the Homeric Iliad, and many people in the audience tend to say, oh, okay, that has been a common practice in Homeric times. Yeah, of course, but it has been a common practice in Homeric times, but it's unacceptable, of course. It's unacceptable, it's morally unacceptable. I think we shouldn't be unclear on that. If we would meet in the Brazilian rainforest a tribe which practices enslaving their enemies and giving slaves as war presents, honorary gifts to the warriors, we should tell them, oh, that's not acceptable. Here comes in my entire justificational idea of a moral philosophy, namely that these enabling transcendental conditions of our capacity to set ends is inescapable. It is inescapable. We have to accept those goods for ourselves, and since we possess in us humanity in the Kantian sense of the homo noumenon, that's a strong point now, we have to think about all these contents in a universalist way. So my enabling conditions of autonomous agency are not that different from Alessandro's conditions and from everyone else's conditions. Roughly like that, I would like to argue.
Thank you very much for your presentations and reciprocate provocations. I think you are feeling provocated to make questions, and now you have the opportunity for it.
Well, first of all, thanks. It was very enlightening. And I'm really sorry to ask this because I'm becoming some sort of rose lawyer. But my question is very simple. At the end of your presentation, you disagreed with Rawls' statement that there's a similarity between justice and a basic structure, and truth to the science, to the systems of thought. And your argument was, we want the system to be just, but also efficient, expensive, cheap, and I cannot see anything like this in science. Well, take for instance Occam's razor. Occam's razor? Well, Occam's razor seems to be much more about efficiency and economy of principles, entities, than about truth. But if I have a scientific theory full of entities, full of principles, that is true, Occam's razor says, all right. Conversely, it seems true that, all right, we want a cheap state, an efficient state, but if to do so, we need to give up a healthcare system, an educational system, we're not to do that because we think that's unjust. So it seems that the comparison holds. That is the question. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. That's a good question, a very good question. I didn't think of that, of Occam's razor, but you, perhaps you are right. I thought of the examples in which many theorists in their high age tend to say, oh, I always preferred elegant theories. Normally physicists say, oh, I like the high symmetry of my theory, or that it is so elegantly formulated. I don't think that this is comparable to the institutional level of a basic structure of society. But perhaps Occam's razor, yes, this economy principle. So formulate a theory as defensive or as parsimonious or something as you possibly can. This might be a little bit similar, but we mean it in the case of social institutions in a stronger form. So the rejection of bureaucracy, for instance, is also a little bit of a moral claim. It's not only an efficiency. I said, of course, it's about efficiency, but also this element that social institutions have to be friendly, open-minded, non-bureaucratic, and this goes perhaps a little bit in a moral direction, which has no analogy. But let me think about it. It's a very interesting point. Thank you.
Yeah. I actually have a question too. So Professor Panzani has made such fraught comments that it makes it very difficult for us to ask questions at this point. But I think I have something that maybe was dealt with, but I keep on looking at your examples and I can't understand why you have a problem with an idea of justice as fairness. With the idea of justice as fairness.
Yeah.
Because I look at each of these examples and I have no problem in reacting to each of them in terms of this ain't fair. Well, this ain't fair, number eight, letter eight, be here, group of nuns, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, this ain't a fair situation. 2A, ain't fair. 2B, this ain't fair either. So in terms of the Rawlsian idea of justice as fairness, of a criteria of fairness that would encompass both the moral and the normative, I just don't understand why you would have a problem with that idea in particular. Probably because of your examples. I mean, during your explanation, I think I was fine with it, but
yes,
in your examples, I have absolutely no problem reacting to that in terms of justice as fairness. And a second question would be also in the standpoint of economics.
May I interrupt you?
Sure.
Excuse me. No, all of these 9 examples to which Alessandro reacted have been anti-million examples. It wasn't addressed against Rawls. What I meant to say against Rawls is this. I believe that according to our ordinary use of justice, it's even not appropriate to speak of the privileged character of rights and liberties as he does in his lexical priority rule. And in the quotation he says,
yeah,
there should be no bargaining and so on. Huh?